First lady saying this threatens the idea of America. You want to respond to that?
Well, I think Doug Brinksley also addresses very, very well. But, you know, this country started with a sense that it was an experiment in democracy. And the democracies had never survived anywhere else in the Western classical world. And the most important thing many historians thought George Washington did as president was to leave the office voluntarily and to have a peaceful transfer of power to a successor elected by, you know, who went through an election. And that was set up a tradition that we've had ever since. If you want to hold a society together, one of the virtues of a democratic society is you do have a transfer of power after an election and people move on. And Donald Trump is now coming along and trying to overthrow that tradition, or at least threatening that tradition. And that's why there's so much of an outcry here, because there's nothing guaranteed about democratic society. You have to work at it. You have to keep working at it. Mm-hmm. And when somebody comes along and says, just burn the whole damn thing down, it's very dangerous.
I think the hero is going to be Pence in the end. You know why? Because I think on the day after the election, if Trump says anything that stimulates his base, even if a million people come out with their pitchforks, Pence is going to get up there and disassociate himself. And he's going to say, no, this was a legitimate election. Because Pence is a decent man who sees his future in politics, and his future is not being associated with Donald Trump's effort to stimulate and stir up the masses against the elected president.
Well, do you remember that John McCain was on the losing side of this issue, and here's what he had to say today. He said, I didn't like the outcome of the 2008 election, but I had a duty to concede, and I did so without reluctance. A concession isn't just an exercise in graciousness. It is an act of respect for the will of the American people. So, Douglas Brinkley, is this what we're talking about here, disrespecting the American people?
Absolutely, and David Gergen said it very eloquently. That's what we admire about George Washington, the ability to step down. We have to hand the baton to the next president. We put the party squabbles behind us. A man named Charles Thompson was the secretary of the Continental Congress, and in the 1800 election, it got so vicious between Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, he deeply worried that that our democracy couldn't survive if we couldn't pull together and legitimize the president. Otherwise, we would just be in constant warfare mode and have utter dysfunction. And Thompson grew deeply distraught that this could happen when you have two-party systems. We've done a good job of pulling together. I mean, look at Franklin Roosevelt, and could run in the middle of World War II with his Republican opponent, then work together. We can go all along through history. This is different, what Donald Trump's doing. It's sinister. It reeks of Joe McCarthy, and it can't be stamped out enough by people that have access to the public airways like we all do.
But again, I know we're paying a lot of attention to this. Are we putting too much attention on it? Because, or is it, as the president said, this is not to be joked about, or even
this is not to be joked about. This is not to be joked about, because people can get out on the street, and he can't control his base. Once he lets that tiger out of the tank, he can't put it back in.
I want to read this. This is a note from George H.W. Bush, and the incoming president, Bill Clinton, went viral after last night's debate. It was a very thoughtful, personal note, and here's what it says. It says, you will be our president when you read this note. I wish you well. I wish your family well. Your success now is our country's success. I am rooting hard for you. Mm-hmm. This couldn't be any more different than what we're seeing right now, and this is the way it's supposed to be, correct?
Now we ask, are they even going to shake hands? It becomes so like weird. A news story when they shake hands. Are you kidding?
Yeah. Let's and even speaking of tonight, when you're saying this is so different, I think Breonna Keeler and Mark Preston said is sort of the wet blanket that is the 2016 campaign. Mm-hmm. This is tonight. This is both candidates and jokes that kind of did not go over so well. Watch this.
They say Donald doesn't have any policies. He has no policies. I keep hearing that. I'd actually like to defend him on this. Donald has issues, serious issues, really, really serious issues.
Now, I'm told Hillary went to confession before tonight's event. But the priest was having a hard time when he asked her about her sins, and she said, she couldn't remember 39 times. Nah. Hillary is so corrupt. She got kicked off the Watergate Commission. How corrupt you have to be to get kicked off the Watergate Commission.
Okay, so I take that back. The issues thing was funny. The second part, I mean, let's just be honest. That, I mean, Douglas, was that funny?
No, it was just not a, that fell flat there. It just wasn't a well-written speech. And Donald Trump isn't that particularly good at delivering those kinds of speeches. He had some good zingers, some fair play tonight, and I think, and there was the handshake this evening.
Yeah.
But the lack of civility and the kind of snarky feel one had, it's just is a kind of a wet blanket. And you feel the public is saying, let's put the get rid of this 2016 election, pull the plug on it as fast as we can. How much more of this do we have to endure?
Yeah, and I was watching, and when they were laughing, I was like, oh, finally they're laughing. You know, yeah. they're being you know, sort of comrades, because they know at the end of the day, one of them's going to be president, mm-hmm. and they're going to have to accept it.
But then he says this thing about that tonight she's pretending not to hate Catholics. That wasn't funny at all. And remember, he has a Catholic running mate that she has, a Catholic running mate, that Trump has been attacking Mexican Americans and Mexicans, most of whom are Catholics. It just was the wrong tone for this kind of an event, and it brought out the worst in him, and I think he got appropriately booed for it.
Last word,
yeah,
David.
Perhaps I'm just showing my biases, but like, I thought there was a real difference. I did not think there was an equivalence between the two of them.
Yeah.
Donald Trump was booed for the first time, I think, in anybody's memory at one of these dinners because of the kind of harshness of his jokes.
That we can remember. Could have happened.
Yeah, but no one we've talked to so far for the last 15 years is remember booing. But he came in, he didn't seem to know the difference between being lighthearted and being heavy-handed, mm-hmm. and he kept being heavy-handed, and I think that it was like we were continuing the spirit of the debate last night as opposed to coming into a different event. I thought she was much more traditional. Some of her jokes didn't work very well, they were flat, but I thought she was at least more appealing. But one of the reason why this matters is these events give you an insight into the character and the personality of the person who may be president, and that's really, really important. Humor is a really important part of leadership, mm-hmm. and if you can do it well, as Kennedy did, as Reagan did, and indeed, most importantly, Lincoln did, it makes a big difference in your capacity.
I'm glad you're being honest, especially when you're talking about the false equivalency, because you have to say, you know, if Donald Trump did really poorly with the jokes tonight, you have to point out how, and I thought she was funnier than
he was,
and more, at least more in spirit of what the dinner was about.
And she saluted the spirit of Al Smith, who was the happy warrior.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate it. Coming up, you heard what Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton said at last